We're in an evergreen shrub bog area that I started studying in the 1980s. They were referred to by the Algonquin Indians as Pocosins. Many of the areas probably have peat that ranges anywhere from 3 feet to 15 feet in depth. So we're talking about areas that are storing massive amounts of carbon. And this peat is roughly 10,000 years old. If you have a system like this, the plants are, with photosynthesis, taking up carbon dioxide. And they're storing it in leaves and roots. And here, when they fall and go into the litter material, this material goes underwater and doesn't decompose very rapidly. And this is what creates your peat. Carbon storage, it's what wetlands do, especially those that are based on peatlands. They basically store carbon in the soil and in the plants. And what you're trying to do is to preserve the amount of carbon that's stored in the soil. One third of the world's soil carbon is in these peatland systems. So with climate change, if these things all oxidize away, we're going to double the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. It's going to create a massive problem. So we're trying to maintain as much peat in this natural state as we can. And so the importance here can't be understated.
Do a third one. That should be good. I can feel it getting.
That'll be a good one. So Dr. Flanagan is using a Russian core, and this Russian core we can get all the way to the base. And this is how we did the original dating of these systems, to find out that they were about 8,900 years old at the base. And this is a really nice core down below. This is all peat in itself. It's all organic matter. It's 90% organic matter. 50% of that is carbon. Most soils have about 1 or 2%. This has 50%. So you know we're storing a lot of carbon. So this is an aluminum ring which we put into the soil. And this ring, once it's placed into the soil to a depth about here, we then have a chamber which goes over the top of this. This gives us a chance to measure soil respiration, both autotrophic and heterotrophic, which means the microbes and the roots themselves, giving us an estimate of the amount of CO2 being released and the amount of methane. And this is from a plot that's had the vegetation removed. So you have very little root respiration left. It's mostly just the microbial. The question we're trying to address here is, what's the contribution of simply the microbes themselves versus the plant roots? And so you're looking at autotrophic versus heterotrophic respiration.
And these plots here that are set up with either nitrogen or phosphorus, or nitrogen and phosphorus together, or control, see what's the effect of nutrient additions on soil respiration and loss, especially of greenhouse gases.
These areas are generally not affected by sea level rise where we are, particularly we're too far inland, but they have been affected by climate change, and they are being affected now by climate change. That's one of the big worries, is what's going to happen to these if we end up with extended droughts? What's going to happen to all this peat, especially if they're drained? So we're trying to get as much of this back underwater as we can. We actually spent a lot of time modeling what would be the water depth, the optimum water depth to actually store the most carbon. And what happens is the water table is way below the surface. You lose the maximum amount of carbon. It goes up as carbon dioxide. And it oxidizes away. The microbes are working really hard on that. So as you raise the water table up to a certain optimum zone, you don't want it flooded all the time. You couldn't do it. And you basically want to keep it moist. You actually can then reduce the amount of carbon that's going to the atmosphere significantly, and you can store more carbon in the soil. If you are a landowner and you have enough land that you're not interested in farming anymore, or it's fallow, or it's burning off like this fire we had in the north, then this is a land that potentially could be turned into a carbon farm, and the profits for an individual could be quite significant. A carbon credit is basically the way you calculate it is the difference between how much is being lost and how much is being stored. That's the credit into the land. There are two or three companies that are quite interested in buying those carbon credits. So I think it's a very viable business in the future for not only the landowner, but also in terms of conservation. This is a scientifically verifiable carbon that is basically carbon that's not going into the atmosphere. You're actually protecting the environment, increasing biodiversity. So this is low-hanging fruit in a sense. This can be considered a fairly easy process by comparison to deep well injections or trying other things. It's not the total solution, it's a partial solution. You know, if 18% of the fallow lands of these peat systems caught on fire in 1 year, it could equal 18% of the CO2 that the government's trying to keep out of the atmosphere. Just normal oxidation, it's about 2.5%. So they make a significant contribution. They're fighting well above their weight in terms of area, because they make up like 0.001% of the landscape, but they produce this tremendous carbon storage potential. So I basically want to give value to these systems that at one time was considered a wasteland.